into our house on Maple Avenue. See how we polish and we shine. We rearrange and realign. Everything is balanced and days and days and days. That's how it happens. Days and days and days. Made of lunches and car rides and shirts and socks and grades and piano. And no one clocks the day you disappear. Days and days and days, that's how it happens. Days and days and days. Made of posing and bragging and fits of rage. And boys, my God, some of them underage. And oh, how did it all happen here? There was a time your father swept me off my feet with words. We read books, strolled through Munich at night, drank beer with friends, discussed the places we would go. And he said I understood how the world made him ache. But no. But no. That's how it happens. Days made of bargains I made because I thought as a wife I was meant to. And now my life is shattered and laid bare. Days and days and days and days and days and days and days. Welcome to our house on Maple Avenue. See how we polish and we shine. We you come back here. I didn't raise you to give away your days like me.
Theater. An entire industry shut down by a global pandemic. In the Wings is a collection of interviews with writers, composers, and creatives whose work was affected by COVID-19. In this series, we will shine a spotlight on those productions, featuring live performances by West End stars and emerging artists. These are the stories of those shows, waiting in the wings. Episode 5, Plan B.
Rosanna McElroy, welcome.
Thank you.
So, Rosanna, tell us a little bit about Plan B and tell us a little bit about yourself. Maybe start with yourself.
Okay, so my background, I started playing the piano when I was 5. Mm. And then I started playing the violin when I was 7.
Wow.
And so music has always been a huge part of my life. And when I was about 10 or 11, I started writing songs. Mm. And then as I got older, I decided I wanted to go to university and study music. So I did a music degree in York. I would say in some respects, I almost feel like music to me has been a bit like osmosis. A lot of things have kind of penetrated through, even though I haven't formally studied composition as such. I did do a master's in songwriting and production more recently. Mm. But when I was writing the songs for the musical, it was very organic. I work in quite an organic way in the sense that I saw the words, started singing stuff, got to the piano and just wrote it. So it wasn't, I know some people write in very different ways and can be more analytical and think, oh, well, I should do this here. And I tended to just get a sense of what the scene was about from the information that I was given, look at the lyrics and then just start singing ideas. And it, so every song that was, I was meant to do 4 songs for the musical, I ended up doing 3, but all the ones that got accepted were written in a very organic way. I wasn't sitting there kind of agonizing over them. And the one that I did write that didn't get used in the end, I had to sit and agonize over it. So I think, yeah, I do think the songwriting masters helped a bit, but I just also think it's an analytical, I think the more you do music and everything, you just, your brain starts to kind of,
so there aren't, there's, it's not really a specific influence, but obviously everything we do in our lives influences us and molds us into the artists that we become.
Yeah, exactly.
Would you be so kind as to give us a brief explanation of the story for Plan B?
It's very female-centric. That's one of the main focuses of the musical. And it's basically about a woman who's in her late 30s and she's frustrated with her life. It hasn't gone the way that she wanted it to go. You know, she's not married and...
She wants to end her life, doesn't she?
She does. But at the beginning, it's kind of a frustration with, I thought I had this plan and it hasn't panned out the way that I wanted it to.
Plan A.
Exactly. Right. And so she does meet someone and he's like, there's a song about that as well, that he ticks all the boxes and everything. It's very quick progression and then it all falls apart very quickly, and that's when she gets to the point of feeling like she wants to end it all because she's kind of lost her sense of who she is and she doesn't even know who she is anymore. All women at some point in their life kind of stop and analyze and look at where they're at, and I think as she's kind of in her late 30s, early 40s, whether or not you adhere to social norms and stuff, I think there's always that slight biological clock is ticking. And with the show and the premise being what it is, that sometimes life takes you in a different route and you can't always bank on what you initially planned for, I think that's more relevant right now than any other time, because obviously so many people as a result of COVID have been in situations where they've planned ahead and thought X, Y, and Z, and then it doesn't work out that way.
There's a face that looks like mine, but it is from another time. A fresh-faced complexion, a different reflection. There's a picture filled with glee, the colors dancing free, the passion and the glory. Vision of her story. There's a piece of her fate inside her self-portrait. Her hopes and her goals, her heart and her soul. A picture paints 1,000 words, but which ones will be heard? With the world looking at you, only you know what is true. Listen to your own design and write your own storyline. There's a change, a dark shadow. It will destroy all that she knows, shatter her perfection, alter her perception. There's a critic at every turn. They don't see their words burn. The spoiling and the tainting, the judgment of the painting. There's a box with a key to change her destiny. Of no return, choose a new direction and a projection. There's a person looking at you, and she can see right through. Time to face up to yourself, not meant to be someone else. There's a chance to create a brand new self-portrait. See your second sight in a whole new light. A picture paints a thousand words, but which ones will be heard? With the world looking at you, only you know what is true. Listen to your own desire.
So tell us your process. I see that there's five different creatives listed, five, and all women. And tell us about how you came about this project and where it's going.
Okay, so Deb's Gerson, she's the person who wrote the script. Mm. And I think she started writing the script about 2 years ago. Mm. And then she brought a songwriter on board called Susie Davis. And Susie wrote a couple of songs for the show. Debs wrote the lyrics, she wrote the music. And from that, the Turbine Theatre decided that they were going to put on a free kind of presentation slash workshop.
And for those in our audience who don't know where the Turbine Theatre is?
It's Battersea.
Okay.
Yeah. So Susie came on board, and then... So they got this slot at the Turbine to kind of present the work, but not as a fully realised theatre show, if that makes sense. And then Susie had other commitments as well, and she had a lot of other things on. So Deb's put out an advert on Art Jobs Online or something. There was like a music thing out there, and that's how I saw it. I was just kind of looking through to see if there were any composition jobs, and I came across this. So... I think lots of different people sent across demos of a specific song that she'd kind of sent the lyrics out and said, have a go at this.
Do you find it strange to go to through somebody's lyrics? Do you find different lyricists easier to write music for compared to other lyricists?
It's an interesting question because I haven't really written for other lyricists. I've only ever written for myself.
Mm. So that must have been an interesting experience.
Yeah, that was an interesting experience. So I... then got on board with the project from that. And then I think also from the submissions that have been sent in, Debs also chose Verity Quaid and Jesse Reeves. Mm. And that's how the creative team kind of came about.
And what are their roles?
So there are four of us that have composed on the show. So there are 18 songs in total. So it's kind of like a four songs.
So Debs is basically the script writer, and she has lyrics, and then she's basically given her lyrics to a flock of other composers to do their thing. Okay.
Yeah. I actually did get to meet Debs in Camden before everything shut down. Mm. And it was interesting because she talked to me about the reasons why she'd chosen one of the songs that now exists in the musical that I'd written. I don't think she decided before that she wanted an all-female team, but I think at the point of getting these submissions in, that was when she thought, actually, there are quite a lot of really strong women here who've written really good stuff, and why not have an all-female creative team?
Shelter somewhere dry. I won't falter or cry. I'll have hope, I'll have faith, I'll be safe. The colours of the rainbow will show me where to go, over the turquoise sea, the soft gold sand of a wonderful new land, my own life, my own way, and there I'll stay. But I can't say goodbye to you. It's something I can't do, so I'll wipe it from my mind.
Everything's going peachy. It was going well. You were writing wonderful music. And then COVID hits.
Yeah.
And so how did that affect you, and how did that affect the show? Where is the show now?
Okay, so at that point in time, it was the 17th of March. That was the last day that they were in Camden, and they just started starting to cast people for the show.
Heartbreaking.
It was a mixture. I think Deb's even said that they were the last people to leave the building, and all the rest of the staff were already waiting in the foyer for them to leave, and that was the last time that they set foot in the space.
Mm.
So from there on, it's been a half of the cast she's met, and then half of the cast have been self-taped, and that's how they got the roles.
Mm.
I think at that point she decided, they thought the COVID thing was going to be about 3 weeks and then they'd be able to get in rooms and we'd be able to work together like that. But at that point, and now that things are the way that they are, they decided instead to focus on getting 18 demos of songs together. So I think it's been more of a kind of a development phase. They've been using this time to develop the script and get dramaturgs in to look at things, and they've had a lot of time there that they wouldn't have had, because originally the presentation was due to be in April at the Turbine. So obviously,
Do you think, in all honesty, do you think it was energy well spent? And I'll tell you why, because I think that we're in a creative business. You're creative. Everyone involved is creative, and they want to create. They have an impetus to create. And then suddenly you're told, nope, no, no, touchy, touchy, and you're in this situation where you can't create. And I think a lot of people are frustrated with that, so they sit at home and write their things, and they put their videos on, and they do their different projects. And you wonder how much of that is productive creativity, and how much of that is just trying not to go insane. Do you think that the process that you know, the idea of bringing in dramaturgical assistance or whatever, do you think that that was necessary? Do you think that was something that you would have done anyways?
For me, it was quite quick anyway. As soon as I got the lyrics, I was kind of excited to write and get on with it and do it.
That's the way to be, yeah.
So it didn't massively impact my creativity in terms of getting the songs.
We've all been given all this time. Have you been able to use this time constructively for your music?
Yeah, I would say that I have, and I think that the time that I've had has afforded me maybe more time to kind of tidy up loose ends and things for the project, where I might not have had as much time. But honestly, it's mainly my own songwriting that has benefited.
I see that there was me and this you in tow. I see both of our faces, all the times and the places. You were part of the picture, made my days all the richer. Two lives that are intertwined, true friends are hard to find. You're like a boomerang, you know where I began, on the journey I am going. You've got quite a knack, you always come back, as a future is growing. If I'm up or down, or out in the town, or round the bend, on you I can depend, my ever. Then I see that you are there to hand me rope. I see the strength that we share as we're both coming up for air. Hold on tight and don't let go as life throws us to and fro. Two lives that are intertwined, two friends are hard to find. Tears on the go for years and the years.
So what do you think the future of theatre is going to be like?
Well, I think through the COVID times, we've realised that we have to be quite adaptable and we have to find different ways of either using our own skill set or drawing on other things that we can do in order to make a living, basically.
Sure. Yeah, I remember a teacher once said to me years ago, it's called show business, not show art. And and you know, if the government would remember that it's a business. This is the brings yeah. tourism and it keeps the blood flow because restaurants rely on all of these things.
We were doing something at the Turbine for free. We weren't. Mm. It wasn't actually a paid. You know, right. The Turbine had decided that from what they'd seen, it was worth giving it a shot.
Right.
And I think there are going to be so many musicals, not just musicals, productions and things that were scheduled.
There'll be the backlog. Yeah.
Exactly. So there's all of that stuff that needs to be sorted out. So kind of, I don't imagine we're going to be a priority, but I do think getting everyone in the room together is going to be, as soon as things do lift a bit more, whenever that will be, that will still be a really important part of it, because you can only get so much of a sense of things on Zoom or a phone call with someone.
Well, the other thing is theater is a dynamic, proactive, get out of bed, go. It's not watching television at home or sitting at Zoom, in front of Zoom and not even bothering to brush your hair. It's a time, the theater is an event. And it requires proactive, dynamic people who are out, and also an audience that's willing to pay a lot more than they would even for a movie.
However, also something interesting that I have discovered during COVID is that people like the National Theatre are obviously putting on shows online. Mm-hmm. And for kids from our school, for example, who've not from quite a deprived area, really, and wouldn't necessarily be able to afford to go to the theatre, have been able to watch things online, guided by the drama teacher or whatever, and actually gained a lot from that.
That is good. That's a good byproduct of this.
Exactly.
I don't know why they don't have free shows for underprivileged kids. I think that you want to build the audience.
Yeah.
I've said that for years. I don't know why there isn't more of that.
But even with Hamilton, for example, now it's on Disney Plus and it's more accessible. They did some kind of poll to see if people, having seen it on TV, would actually bother going to see it live. Yeah. And 50% of people said that they would. So I think...
Which means a good thing for Hamilton, because I'm sure that there's a lot more people who saw it on TV in one night.
Exactly.
Than would see, because the most you can get in the theater is maybe, 1,500 people.
Yeah.
Even in a week, but on one night you get millions.
Yeah, and I don't think necessarily having it televised or whatever is going to prevent people from wanting to go to
Absolutely.
The theatre. It might actually have the opposite effect.
Rosanna, I want to thank you so much for coming in today and sharing these experiences. I think it means so much to the audience watching this show to know that they're not alone in their experiences and their fears and their hopes and dreams. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.